Welcome back, everybody, to CIS Rejects versus Power Rangers, game number 3. It was looking like there we were never going to get our game 3, as CIS Rejects took forever and a half to get a stand-in, but they finally have one. I Go Ham is going to be rounding out their lineup. Third stand-in for the third game. It's something that is special for CIS Dota, I guess. Anyway, I've got Scance joining me for this game 3, as he's been doing the whole series with me. Scance, first pick Nightstalker, what do you think?
I think that Nightstalker did a lot of work for Power Rangers last game. Mm-hmm. So CIS Rejects rightly deciding that if they're not going to ban it, they need to first pick it. And well, they had the first pick, so figure that they've got just as good a Nightstalker as Power Rangers have. I mean, Nightstalker is a really strong hero in the current meta, but it's very rare to see it have that much of an explosive start to the game. We spoke about it at the beginning of last game, where as the first knight hits, CIS Rejects for some reason decided to take a fight at the rune, and so the Nightstalker got a double kill and a fast turn, and then just started to snowball. So I don't know if it's going to have that kind of impact in this game.
Yeah.
But they still wanted to shut it down and take it for themselves.
Lich Spectre, the response being now a bane for CIS Rejects, one of the more valued kind of defensive heroes. A lot of high amount of control out of a bane, but why do you think they chose bane over anybody else, such as, say, the Dazzle that's still in the pool, or you could have chosen one of those more offensive supports to run with the Nightstalker? Why a bane?
So, one of the things about Bane might be that, even though it's considered to be defensive in many ways, because of the Nightmare setup, if we expect Power Rangers to run Lich plus one as an aggressive dual lane, and Bane's going to be the safe lane support for CIS Rejects, then that kind of commits the Lich to being there all the time. And we've seen in the previous game, and we've seen a few times when we've seen Lich recently in professional Dota, often Lich players like to walk around, go make stacks, deny from more than one lane. So it could be that that's part of the thinking, that the ban plus one safe lane is going to actually force you to fix your lanes. And what that does then, if the Lich plus one needs to stay there, is it leaves Spectre with only one support, and CIS Rejects themselves could put a lot of pressure on that Spectre.
Mm. Okay, yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. The Ancient Apparition and Venomance are going to be banned away by CIS Reject. We have a Huskar banned away by PR. They're not going to get Huskard. Again, what's the last ban out for them, though?
I gotta say, PR to me look like the stronger team in this series. I mean, they're certainly the team that's used less stand-ins. I mean, they've finally got the same lineup 2 games in a row, and that can't be said for any of the games for CIS Rejects. And I think that if not for the Huskar in game 1, we might have seen a 2-0 for PR here. So in that sense, coming into the draft, I kind of put the pressure on CIS Rejects to see what they can get done. And it's interesting with that in mind that Power Rangers start with a Spectre in their draft, which is kind of like, to me, it kind of is a pick that says we're confident in our ability that we're better than you, and so we're just going to pick this like safe, standard, straightforward way of winning the game, which Spectre really represents.
So you're probably going to need. I do like to, even if you do pick up the Spectre and expect to run, you know, a little bit more late game, I still like to see Spectre run in lineups that can get aggressive around that 15-25 minute marker. And I was going to say, I really want to see a big tempo controller as your mid laner. I'm not sure if Lina is actually going to be their mid or if it's going to be their other support. But Lina, I guess, would be the type of hero. For me, I didn't actually think Lina. I was actually thinking something like the... What would have been better for a tempo controller? I guess there's not really much left.
Yeah, I think Lina has to be mid, yeah. I think that if you're running Spectre with Lina and Lich as your supports, you're in big danger, especially if we expect the Lich. We very rarely see Lich in like a safe tri lane. I don't think he really functions optimally there. And if he's with the mid lane or the off lane and you're running just Spectre plus Lina against a, you know, Nightstalker plus whatever, possibly, I don't know, Witch Doctor or... That's really asking for trouble. So I would say Lina is like 90% mid here, and CIS Rejects will probably be operating on that assumption. And they don't have to. They actually don't have to go anywhere right now in the draft. They could pick their mid. They could just leave it for a while. They might. What I was speaking about earlier, they might want to have a safe laner, which combines really nicely with Bane when you do catch people alone, just to guarantee the dynamic that I was talking about earlier. Whether they want to take that safe laner now, there's a lot of heroes. There's like the direct and obvious combinations like Mirana or even Leshrac or Gyrocopter. But there's actually a lot of heroes that, as long as you have kill potential, really, and you're laning with a Bane against one hero, you can usually set up those kills.
Visage. Radiant team
pick. This Visage pick like actually presents something totally different to me. It makes me think that could be an offensive tri-lane, but wow, okay. And what way to knock the tempo back? Because I was just about to say CIS Rejects might be presenting an aggressive tri-lane, and then we see a Broodmother pick, which can do all sorts of things to get in your way when you're trying to set up those kind of laning situations.
Yeah, because then what are you left with? You can't really run... You'd have to change up your lane so completely, I think, because now you can no longer run the Nightstalker 1v1 against the Broodmother. And then run an aggro tri-lane. So I guess you'd have to run, like, Midnight Stalker or something and put, like, I don't even know, Legion Commander or something against the Broodmother.
There's sort of a poetic justice to it that Power Rangers in Game 1 got Huskard by CS Reject, and now they're brooding them back, which is... It's
one of those... It's one of those picks, man!
Exactly, it's like... those are probably, like, the number one and two picks of that type. Just come up at some late stage of the draft and suddenly you're like, we didn't have a plan for that, and what? that's their plan. The axe. This I think transcribes like a lot of what they need to do, how their lanes will be set up. And axe is gonna be stuck with brood all game, and something that better brood teams have shown recently, especially Virtus.pro and Vega, to my mind, is that having a hero that deals with Broodmother does not necessarily mean you're fine. Because that hero needs to be there all the time. Broodmother's exerting that control on the map, and oftentimes the Broodmother gets more farm anyway.
Yeah, I mean, he utilizes the jungle most of the time. We've even seen, have you seen the Broodmother that doesn't go for levels in Spiderlings when he's facing an axe?
Yeah, and he just attacks him and outplays him and wins the lane.
Yeah, like as soon as he picks up level 6, he's like, okay, go ahead. Spin all you want. You're not escaping me, and I'm gonna out lifesteal your spin quite easily, so... we'll see if that actually happens for this game, but most of the time, Broodmothers just utilize the jungle a bit more as they spawn more and more Spiderlings and just never keep them in lane. Last man out.
I think Power Rangers need a stun. I think they need a stun.
It seems.
I mean, they have. Seconds remaining. Yeah, they have Lina stun. They have Chain Frost, but those are not like sort of fight kind of stuns, are they?
No, I agree with you. What about Ruby? Because you have a Bane on the other side. Pretty easy steal.
Yep. That's good. I think that's pretty legit. I really like the Rubik suggestion here. I mean, if they want to be greedy and not pick a stun here, they could like rely on Lina getting farm and Yule starting everything, but I think that is very dangerous. Especially when your other cores are Spec and Brood. Like, Lina's a bad start, there's not a lot of space for her to catch up, so I'm gonna go with your Rubik suggestion, unless they can think of, like, some other better stun. Whereas CIS Rejects are still waiting for their mid hero, probably. I mean, we've seen some teams run the Nightstalker mid recently. Yeah. Most notably, I think it was Secret, actually, at MLG, but... it's not clear to me that that's what they want to do in this game.
Oh, they are going to be running a support Lina. Beastmaster is now matched up against the Nightstalker mid. But that's the thing. They didn't actually... They don't think it's a Nightstalker mid. They think the Nightstalker is actually running with the tri-lane because they banned away the SF, which would have been the mid hero. So, yeah, they're just putting Beastmaster, I guess, in the middle lane. No matter what the matchup is, and they're going to be running Lina as the support to the Spectre. I see a lot of opportunities for CISR to win an aggro tri-lane here and still do alright against the Broodmother, but we'll see. The Alchemist being picked up, you've got 1, 2, 3, 4 different Ags targets. None of them are amazing, though. The Visage is obviously the best one if you can get him the Aghanim Scepter while he also has a Solar Crest. then you're going to be having a forward position that's incredibly powerful, but...
You know, this is the first time I've seen an Alchemist pick up in a CIS versus CIS matchup, and my feeling is that with these two teams, there's going to be like a... I don't think Power Rangers just want to give that Alchemist a bounty rune. They're not really a lineup that's designed for fighting at level 1, not at all, but I would not be surprised if they tried to look for them the moment they've dodged each other, but I just don't see Power Rangers being satisfied leaving that bounty rune, the Alchemist.
Yeah, they may try and go for an early kill here inside the jungle, but that's immediately spotted out by Goblack. I really think CISR just, in my opinion, just run at the top lane. Obviously, it would be safer just to ensure that Alchemist gets bottom bounty rune, but... I mean, between Broodmother, Spectre, Lich, you have zero level 1 fighting power between those three heroes.
Yeah, I think that Power Rangers' approach was to hope to get lucky. They were hoping Alchemist would come to top rune, they're going to just go in, get a quick kill, deny him the rune, and start the game all, but... He's at bot rune, so he's gonna get his bounty rune, and it's actually exactly as you said, this is actually still not that bad for Power Rangers, given that they couldn't really take a fight, the one that they were looking for.
Alright, so the Alchemist picks up that free 500 gold, how absurd is that? Beastmaster saving a bit of gold because he's gonna be going the bottle build here up against the Alchemist. Probably necessary against, like, melee versus melee against Acid Spray. You're going to need a significant amount of sustain.
Interesting, they've not even given Goritz a sentry ward to take this 1v1 lane. Maybe they didn't expect it would be a 1v1 lane against the Brood.
Oh yeah, they probably thought they were going to have the matchup of the Axe, right? I mean, why take an Axe if you're not going to match it against them?
Yeah, that sounds reasonable. Nightstalker's base stats and armor, and he's got a star shield, not too bad. So right at the start, he should be okay against the Brood, but... Mm-hmm. I think very quickly he'll stop being okay, and maybe CIS Rejects will consider a lane switch.
Yeah, I still like this because of the fact that he'll do all right in the first couple of levels, and it kind of ensures your Nightstalker gets a free level 3. And then they're also keeping the Axe alone in lane, so it's not like he's being gimped by the fact that he's got a support taking his experience. So, and he should do fine in this matchup because, well, Lich doesn't have a stun, and Spectre... The dagger does such a minimal amount of damage, 50 damage. All it does, that he should be very easily able to stand against lane.
Yeah, I think the 3v3 lane favors CIS Rejects, whether it's with the Axe or the Nightstalker, to be honest. And we can see Spectre's not actually getting that much.
To sit back, wait for the lane to push in. How's our mid lane gonna go? I expect it to go the way of the Alchemist.
Yeah, he's looking pretty comfortable for now.
Yeah,
he did get that one bounce here in.
He feels so good, he goes for the second level Goblin Screed rather than Acid Spray. That's how you know you're feeling.
I'm just half expecting, like, large amounts of action to break out on the top lane at any second, just because of the nature of the games and the teams and what we've been seeing.
Yeah.
It's not clear to me that there's an easy route for either of them to start the aggression, but actually Axe TP's down to their bot lane.
So they're going to start switching up now. I think this is about the right time once the Broodmother hits level 3. That's really where scary things start happening. Plus, you actually, in a way, force the Broodmother to go for the level of that spawn spiderlings. Because what if you're matched up against a Nightstalker the whole entire time, you know? You don't want to not have levels.
And there's the dodge. Spectre's going bot. I was going to say, I mean, when we hit that 4-minute mark, first night... All of a sudden, this lane is unlaneable for Power Rangers. So, definitely the correct move in my view, to just completely dodge.
Seems like they're gonna win every single lane, the way that this is setting up. I mean, the Alchemist is definitely winning his lane right now. 18-2 compared to 10-3 on Zara.
I guess something to keep in mind is that to just win the lanes is maybe not actually good enough for CIS Rejects. Sure, they've got an Alchemist who's going to farm really well, but it's not actually especially strong carry with the farm. And Spectre is. Spectre absolutely is. You've also got the Beastmaster, which is one of the best supporting things as the game goes later.
Yeah.
There's a dive at top lane.
Yeah, I don't know what that was all about. I was watching that. I was just like, Goretz, are you really doing that?
He's just annoyed because there's like nothing happening. He was told there'd be a party up here, and there hasn't been one yet.
Yeah, apparently not. But you are right. They can't just win their lanes. Yeah, they have to actually utilize winning their lanes into shutting down the Spectre, which will come in, I'm sure, especially the second night. First night time, Goretz may still want to focus on getting farm and just maintaining his laning presence, but level 2 night time, I'm sure they're going to be trying to hunt down the Spectre as much as possible and prevent that Radiant.
Yeah, there's also questions to be asked about Axe right now, the way the lanes are going, but also in the draft in general. I'm pretty sure Axe was picked just directly to deal with Brood. Well, he's TPing top to go deal with Brood. This is a hero that's, in general, fallen out of favor massively since there were a couple of nerfs after 6.83, and I mean, I don't know what you think. Well, mid lane first, there's an attempt, but there's no stun on Alchemist, so I don't think they can make that kill. I wanted to ask, I mean, do you think Axe is a good hero right now, like, generally speaking?
No, I think he's completely situational. He's entirely based on winning, I think, one versus one matchups, which the most notable one is going to be Broodmother.
Alright, so then, in that case, I don't know, I mean, look at the Axe CS right now, look at the Brood CS. Sure, they haven't actually been matching up against each other that much, but Axe is going to, like, quite quickly become a bit lost in this game, potentially, if he doesn't get a fast blink and start ganking.
Yeah. Nice dodge on the Light Strike array. Goretz is actually playing pretty aggressively as the Night Stalker.
No.
Which is a pretty interesting idea, because what they're giving up is actually a dual lane scenario at the top lane, with Bane kind of backing up Goretz as the aggressive player going into the Spectre constantly. And he's able to make those kind of rotations through to the middle lane potentially as well, as we saw earlier. Leap, J4. They do have the mana with the double Mangos build. They certainly can kill J4, and they know it too. They're just going to be able to right-click him down. Goretz is the target of a Lich Nuke, but that by itself won't be nearly enough.
I mean, I spoke in the draft, like, Lich is not the kind of hero, oh, you TP in a level 1 over someone, well done. Like, Lich is meant to be like a lanes are stable, dominate the lane by casting Sacrifice a lot kind of hero. And that's definitely one place in which I think CIS Rejects win out in this lane phase, with all the lane switching just going to work against the effectiveness of the Lich.
Right.
Although the CSs are, I mean, Power Rangers CSs are actually not looking too bad at all. So they're looking reasonable in terms of farm.
Yeah,
I don't know how they deal with the aggression as a plan with the Lina Lich as their supports, but they've only lost one hero so far.
Beastmaster is certainly going to have to be a big part, but he really won't be ready until Wild Axes are maxed out, I think. Beastmaster, I think, is as an offlaner, is much more farmy than most others, and as a mid, he still is kind of more passive and farm-oriented than many other mids that you would see. Maybe he's better reactionary, I would say, but especially with the maxed out Hawk build.
Well, he's coming into this bot lane looking for someone to roar, I think, but if he roars the Night Stalker this far out, it's not a kill.
No, it's certainly not.
And especially actually, it looked like he tried to cast it and Night Stalker fogged him, but it might be for the best, because that's definitely not a kill if he roars him at that position.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. J4 will take over the middle lane, Visage doing something similar as the support splitting that up. Iceberg went back in, tried to farm up his jungle. Cheshire Cat is going to be taking most of that over, though, so Radiant's top tower is they could go for a combination if they bring Alchemist or Visage low enough.
So a very strange game for the series, with one kill in the first 8 minutes. Whereas in the other two games, it felt like, especially in the first game, it was like an early mid game after like, or was that the second game? I don't even know actually.
Yeah.
The boar is just holding down the Alchemist here.
It was full of action. Kill the boar! Get it! Black gets to sleep. Looks like they're gonna go for J4 here, slowing him down. Lightstrike array is up. He gets it off, but not before he gets dunked. And there's not much. Well, Zarya's actually gonna turn and fight Iceberg, but this is 5-man mid. CIS Rejects, they're gonna harken back to the game of old. We're gonna see just all inning in the middle lane.
Iceberg has a relic, by the way. We didn't talk much about Alchemist since the start, but that is the hero, that is how it works. He went for a greedy build, he had that first bounty rune, and like the quiet game with no action, and suddenly there's an Alchemist with a relic. So pressure is absolutely on Power Rangers now. Oh. Because if he gets that fast Radiance and he keeps progressing at a normal rate, it's like, you're in trouble.
Yeah, it's usually like, what's the standard time? You got 12, 13 minute?
Yeah. 12 minute Radiance, pretty, I would say, standard.
So absurd. The Nightstalker even took the last bounty rune.
Ishagat's been dusted, but...
he just hides in the trees. As long as he doesn't take damage, okay, now he takes damage. He's still fast enough, it looks like, to stay ahead of the Axe. It'll be okay there. Spectre is actually going to go for gold black here. This is dangerous play because there's still the Nightmare. And now he's going to be caught in an awkward position underneath the Acid Spray. And this is just a lot of lost farming time. Ramses gets a call on a little bit of Spiderlings. Nothing major, though. They're going to go for the Visage. Actually do manage to catch him out as they rotate on through the Acid Spray. Five heroes from Power Rangers this time around. Overwhelming CIS rejects. Shows your cat. Actually, he's going to pop the Life Steal here and go for this, but they don't have the Chain Frost, so they can't stop the TP out.
So the two ways that I've seen teams beat this farming Alchemist, one is to just, at this stage, now he's got a relic, they're going to just keep going into his jungle and stopping him from farming and slowing him down a lot, making a lot of kills on him. The other is to just try and like actually out-farm him, even though he'll get farm quicker to get more useful farm. And I think that Spectre's a hero that could use the farm better, but Spectre's actually also a hero that doesn't get the farm that well. I mean, most of Spectre's farm is just individual last hits. So I don't think the racing approach works. I think that Power Rangers need to go for the aggressive approach and just try to either kill Alchemist a bunch of times or put so much pressure on him that his farm slows down dramatically. They've started by taking the tier 1 top. And this will definitely open access to the Dire Jungle, which is where the Alchemist wants to get a lot of his farm from. But he's gotten the Radiance just from the lane, so...
Just your cat having a man fight with Ramses. But it's not enough. He's got to play a little scared, especially with rotation. I think J4, they need to give J4 the middle lane or something. Lina feels rather useless without level 6 by this point.
I still feel like this Lina Lich support duo has just been a mistake in this draft, and
yeah, I agree.
It's showing at every level.
I was with you when you said the Lina kind of had to be mid. I don't see the effectiveness of the hero. Just your cat didn't have enough mana for the nuke, but was able to force a TP out from the visit. Iceberg farming up some stacks inside the Radiant jungle, because he can, why not?
Yeah, they've taken over his jungle, but he's just casually farming theirs, and he's going to run straight into the Spectre now, who is not in a position to fight him.
Nope. Runs in, runs out, and this will be farm for Iceberg.
I think once Alchemist has his next item, it's like... I mean, he's going to go travel, so I guess once he has travels and Manta, because I presume that that's the board he goes. Usually you don't see fast Radiance into like buying people eggs. Once he gets Travels Manta, that could easily be like in the next 10 minutes or so, and it's really, really, really heavy days for our Rangers at that stage, because honestly, the Lina and the Lich are both like a bit roleless at the moment. The Brood has not had that impact that we expect Brood to have, which absolutely controls the game.
Roar, they're gonna try and go on Iceberg, he doesn't have enough regen there. In place, safe enough, farming up is the Alchemist. Great pickoff for Power Rangers. That'll actually complete the urn for the Spectre. Going for that kind of build because you don't really have much options. You didn't get enough farm in the early game to go Radiance right away, so you gotta get some early stats.
They actually gave the Alchemist so much that he, I think, just became complacent and he was like, oh, this game's easy, they're just never stopping me. And does die once for it. There's a little bit of interaction between Lina and Bane here, but Bane won't get the sleep. Lina actually has an urn, and Spectre's about to buy an urn too.
Yeah, that's a little awkward, especially since the Lina, I think, has higher value items that you could start building into.
Their team is not really getting very many kills. This is a low kill game, so... I mean, sometimes having two urns, if there's like a ton of kills happening all over the map, it's fine, but... they'll feel it in this game, I think.
Yeah. Do you think Treads was the build for Spectre? I kind of feel like if you go the aggressive build, you almost have to go phase.
Yeah, that usually is. You go phase boots when you want to fight early on. But it's awkward because it's like, that's what he wants to do, but he knows his team can't really do that. Then he has to prioritize not dying. It's, I just think the draft puts Power Rangers in a pretty awkward position, especially where the game isn't about Broodmother. If this game was about Broodmother, if the entire early game was like CIS Rejects trying to deal with Broodmother, which I feel like it could maybe have been, then the whole story's different, but...
Wait, what? Did you see this? Cheshire Cat win Basher? Did you notice this?
Just saw it right now, and he tried to go on the axe, but didn't really get much down there. Axe has actually rushed the Vanguard, doesn't have a blink first, so works quite well against this approach to Broodmother.
I saw the stun and I was just like, he didn't. Did he really? He did. This is gonna be caught, rotation out for the Beastmaster. There is a Boots of Travel TP in. Alchemist is so big that he can fight against three different heroes, I guess. Spectre Ultimate now goes out, and they're still gonna try and fight this one, even up against the double damage, but here comes the rest of the CIS Rejects. Nice Light Strike Array, but it looks like they'll catch Zara. Turns around, throws out the Wild Axes, because he knows he's dead. Now the question is, the rest of ARCADE Power Rangers gonna be able to get out? Looks like the answer to that is a quite definite no. Spectre is rather tanky, and might just be able to dagger out. Oh god, it's so close, but still goes down to Goretz in the end, thanks to that Void. Behind
have
the
you
tower.
Seen J4?
Yeah. Wait in and out. Iceberg will just claim the tower, though.
They don't know he's here, but he doesn't have a TP, so this is a lot of time wasted. And I don't know if he makes a run for it to the side shop now, or it's even more time wasted. This is already a Lina we discussed that wasn't really achieving match or getting match done in the game. X has spotted you.
You've been spotted. Oh my god. He gets a little lucky with the spins and he'll get the chop. Goretz was coming in from behind anyway, so that's actually turns out to be what? Three heroes essentially dead? They got the Spectre, the Beastmaster, and then even J4 still died at the end.
And now there's a blink up on Axe, so there's that constant threat of initiation. Nightstalker is very, very close to Aghanim Scepter. And it's bad when you're up against this super high-performing Alchemist. But you're not the team that can put the aggression on the other team, and that's what it feels like. And I'm still waiting to see the impact of the Broodmother. Come to
Axe. Careful with your spiderlings. Oh. So bad. Better have a fight. Lich is dead. Looks like they're still gonna try and gore on Goretz with the Light Strike Array and the ultimate. Yeah, they actually get the kill, so they're good. They get that one, Ramses, with his Blink Dagger. He will be just fine.
Yeah, I think there's going to be a timing when Nightstalker has Ags. Where for the first few minutes of that Ags, it's just... Firstly, Alchemist is free-farming, because you're not going near him, because they have map control. And secondly, all your heroes are at risk of dying all the time. It's difficult if you're Power Rangers. There's quite a lot of gold that's built up on Spectre over the last couple of minutes, though, and...
On an iceberg, but every right-click is being outdone by the HP regen. Now they actually cancel his TP. Oh, if the bounce back had been there, they definitely would have gotten the kill. Looks like Broodmother's going to be able to round around, though, and catch Iceberg, hopefully be able to slow him down. Body blocking him up. Oh, the Radiant's cleaning up a lot of Spiderlings, though, and it's going to clean up Big Dub 2 if he's not careful. 13 HP and he goes down. The ticks are there. Iceberg, his ultimate finally runs out. They're going to try and wait for that unstable concoction and maybe still go on him. Messages here on the side. They're going to try and nuke down Cheshire Cat. They'll just barely be able to do so. They get the Alchemist finally, but he already got plenty of kills and plenty of Spiderlings as well.
I was about to remark about how it's a mistake of CIS Rejects to leave the Alchemist there on his own, but the fact that he gets so much done before his team even arrives.
And now J4 as well. Necronomicon level 2 for the Beastmaster, but it's not going to mean much against a lot of this team. The Axe, the Mana Burn's going to be annoying, but he'll still get extra spins if he makes the right initiation with his Blink Dagger.
Alright, so This reminds me now of game one. We're in this position. Game one, we're talking about the Husk and CIS rejects. PR just needs to survive it. They might be okay. I feel the same about Nightstalker's Ags at this point. I feel like the game could be totally out of control for Power Rangers in 10 minutes time. And if it isn't, if they like manage to maintain stability, Spectre keeps farming, hits Radiance, maybe another item, then they're not looking that terrible. But it's this 10 minute period that's going to be vital to them staying in the game or being completely knocked out of it.
I really love the timing on Alchemist Visage. Now with the new builds on Visage where they go Solar Crest. Because the Solar Crest comes in about the same time as an Alchemist would be able to get you an Axe a lot of the times. So you hit this like gigantic, you go from sort of like being a regular 4 position to like this gigantic peak as a support when it comes to efficiency. Once you have the Axe and the Solar Crest, like that can single-handedly win a lot of fights.
Yeah, you instantly become like one position carry level out of nowhere, which
yeah.
is pretty huge. And Cheshire Cat up here being chased away by the Alchemist, he's picked the Hyperstone.
Get him! Oh. Get him! Get the Spinerlings! Nom 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 nom!
So his strategy is to hit you really fast and bash you. That's... It's pretty transparent. There's no subtlety here. It's just like, I'm gonna attack you.
Or Light Strike Array, Laguna Blade, and they'll get the kill on Ramsey's. Nice pick off for PR. And a kill that Spectre desperately needed, actually, because that actually brings him pretty close to his relic. We may see a Radiance of our own here on the side of Power Rangers.
Yeah, Axe is like near the top of the net worth. It's not a kill they want to be throwing away. And this is exactly what I was talking about in comparison to that first game where we said that CIS Rejects were gifting a few kills and a few bad situations, and they need to be careful not to do that here again, because Spectre could all of a sudden have a Radiance of his own.
Goretz going for the kill alongside Iceberg. The only hope here is really that Spectre's able to get out with the dagger, the Chain Frost bouncing around, they get a good Light Strike right on top of this, maybe the Chain Frost is enough! It bounces back, kills Goretz. Looks like they'll lose Big Num as well as the Spectre though with the double kill, and now J4's gonna get cleaned up as well, the Familiars. Managing to stop that TP out. Maybe he actually does escape though. Iceberg can catch up for the unstable concoction. And J4 gets away. In the meantime, Cheshire Cat battling up against Ramses. Doesn't have enough. Ramses chops off one of his limbs and takes down the Broodmother. Another notch, 9-13. Things are getting up rather rapidly. CIS Rejects winning that fight despite the really great Chain Frost that was there. And it bounced perhaps just a bit better, maybe they could have killed Iceberg as well.
Yeah, are we establishing in this series that Lich is actually good because of Chain Frost? It's not about sacrifice, it's not about it's just like...
Chain Frost is the new Black Dota, in CIS Dota, yes. In other regions, maybe not, I don't know. I guess I'll have to see it to believe it, you know.
I mean, it kind of makes sense if we're talking about like the lower tier CIS Dota, where the like still proving themselves teams,
yeah.
Where it's like the only option is keep fighting, and there's this Chain Frost, but you like have to keep fighting. It's gonna punish you. There's a pretty big ancient stack. Now gonna be 3 made for the Alchemist, and he's already sitting on another 6k gold. Every time you look away from this hero, I mean, if the net worth is just ridiculous, he's twice as rich as the next richest person.
Yeah, he could actually get like some sort of top and get the Broodmother. Mass TPs, but all of them are going to be canceled. But it seems like he could actually get himself like a heart or something and be truly unkillable and then still be like 2 minutes away from an Aghanim Scepter for the Visage.
And we're going to see right now. He's
The Octarine Corp, right. I forgot about that build. Top tower is under attack. All right, let's forget about the Octarine as part of this build.
You need to remember that Alchemist is Nagasaren. That's all you need to remember.
That actually is the best description of him right now.
And he's chasing off Davina right now.
Oh, you are so fast, but you're still going to stun yourself, J4. Issues? He lands that Light Strike Array, but he is certainly dead.
So, Spectre has farmed a relic. The Courier needs to go fetch it, but Axe has caught Lich out. And Alchemist TP's in, that's a dead Lich. But I was going to say, Spectre's farmed a relic, but I've hardly ever felt like a relic was less relevant, to be honest. It's not just now that he needs to hit his Radiance. He needs to hit his Radiance and they need to get given a lot. Well, mid, they're going to be given a Bane Elemental, I think. Yeah, Visage, sorry.
That's actually a pretty good 628 gold. That's how far ahead they are in net worth that a Visage is worth that much. So that'll actually be, like, the relic was picked up and all of a sudden, boom, like, Radiance is here.
Yeah, another disturbing thing in this game is that it's not just the Alchemist that's like leaps and miles ahead of everyone in net worth. His Axe is actually the second highest. Usually you want to at least see if you're against this Alchemist. Sure, he's very rich, and that's just how the hero works. But you've got like the next richest person because he's taking so much space off the map. And that's not the case, your Axe is right up there. I wonder what the Axe buys next. Does he buy one of those big armor items like a Shiva's or AC? Or does he maybe go into a BKB? Just the like Spectre damage and the Chain Frost damage.
I think Shiva's would be best. It's a little bit awkward because you already have the Yules. Usually you get a lot of value out of that extra intelligence on the Axe, where here it's not as necessary, but I still think the Shiva's works out really well against the Spectre in multiple situations. Cheshire Cat is trying to go onto the Visage, but it's not going to be able to get him in time, and all those Spiderlings will be burned away.
Yeah, so Cheshire Cat did really well in, I want to say, in both of the first two games. In this game, he's done a lot of things, but I'm, like, hesitant to say that they've been, like, it really is. Normally, you're looking at the Broodmother all the time, and, like, how can the enemy team deal with Broodmother? And this is, like, every now and then we go up and see, hey, what's Broodmother doing? And I think that's quite telling.
Well, there it is. The Aghanim Scepter is here. So Visage is about to go all the way up to second in net worth. So it might be third behind the Axe, but still, like, that's absurd that this Visage is going to essentially be a second core.
And it's actually, this is also very significant because so Spectre has Radiance, but who's going to actually struggle to live through Spectre's ulti? Maybe Bane struggles a bit. I don't even think he does. And usually that's, I mean, a big part of Spectre's Radiance is when you hit that timing, the first time you haunt, it's a huge swing in the fight, and I don't think it's going to be that necessarily. Again, depending on whether CIS rejects are overextending or making mistakes.
Yeah, I mean, Visage has 47 armor right now with a maxed out Gravekeeper's Cloak and the plate mail that he just picked up because he didn't show Ags. And the Bane is, I think the Bane is, like, he's so separated from, like, he's not going to be a frontliner most of the time, right? So if you Spectre ult and go on him, then you're just susceptible to a Fiend's Grip or a Nightmare. No, you're not going to be with your team, most likely, if you go on Bane.
This is absolutely CIS Rejects' game to win or throw. That's how I feel.
Yeah,
I agree. Difficult to imagine. Like, normally I think that's an exaggeration when people say that, but it's difficult to imagine that Power Rangers could make a play so big that doesn't depend on CIS Rejects making a mistake to get into the game.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Completely agree. They're gonna try and push down middle lane right now. They should probably just push uphill, to be honest. The Roshan being down and the top lane being pushed Radiant's out. Middle tower has fallen. Ramses gets a really good initiation.
Well, they've just TP'd the Alchemist bot, so they probably want to avoid taking that fight straight away. Actually, there's a response TP. Beastmaster's come down, but these two together cannot kill Alchemist. Not enough.
Yeah, especially with his ultimate opt already. The AC is here for Iceberg. That was probably one of the big items that they wanted to wait for. Cheshire Cat's going to be caught. Fiend's Grip away. Go Black might as well use this Fiend's Grip because you're not going to see a better opportunity for it. Plus, he really hasn't had the opportunity to do much in this game.
They're going to go to Alchemist now. I'm pretty sure of it. He does have a Visage nearby, but he doesn't have ulti just yet.
Blow him down, but the Visage is on the side, and that just blows it up. The Chain Frost is going to bounce back to Iceberg, but the Familiar's dropping actually gives him the turnaround potential. Now the nuke goes out on the Beastmaster. He pops the Necronomicon minions, but he's too late to the fight. He's just going to get taken out. The Spectre gets away, but the rest of Power Rangers suffering quite heavily in trying to go for that Alchemist, and it wasn't even close.
Yeah, they figured that he just TP'd down there, they saw his allies on the other side of the map, and there's like that 8 second downtime of his ulti. They had two heroes there already, I said it wasn't enough, Lich came in, but just the fact that Visage was there, or it's another dead lane in mid lane.
And now the Spectre's gonna be chased out, they're actually gonna go for this one. They have the Blink up, they have the Alchemist coming in. What? Ramses didn't go for the Blink, I thought he was gonna be in range. Now he catches, but it's a bit too late for that one, my friend. Or is it? Iceberg just comes barreling on forward, and that's gonna be the Spectre going down. Chopped up, Cheshire Cat now pops out of his hold. Not for long, though. Has to go right back into the pound. Iceberg just throws out some anti-illusions. And they'll go back now to finishing up this Tier 3 tower. But Power Rangers call it. I mean, you said it. A professional team like this is actually calling the game. They very clearly feel the exact same way, which is there is really no way to recover from this.
Yeah, I think I still maintain that Power Rangers came into this Game 3 as the stronger team. I think they looked stronger in Game 1s and 2, but
yeah.
Draft, I don't like the Lina and Lich together, and I don't think they got Broodmother level value out of their Brood pick.
I would completely agree. They didn't shut down the Alchemist enough, they didn't do well enough on the Broodmother.